Good morning, good morning. We can come on in and get our seat. Sorry, I like listening to all the fellowship, but we have a time. So good morning, how are we doing? All right. So we want to welcome you all here at the Church of Christ in Walnut Creek. Glad you're here in the pews with us. We are glad you're with us online. I wish we could say good to see you, but we're glad you're online with us. It's good to see everyone here. We've got a full day today. If some of you guys have read Dave's email, we got a bunch of welcome backs from camp, op camp, the staff and campers, and we got some congratulations with some high school graduates and eighth grade graduates, and then we have some goodbye. But we're not going to say goodbye. We're just going to say bye. We'll see you later. So I don't like the word goodbye. But if you can, let's grab a hand next to us, and we'll have a little prayer before our worship. Father in heaven, we come to you to thank you for everything you've done for us. Lord, thank you for bringing everyone here to this building. Thank you for the people that are online watching us. We ask you to bless them all. Lord, be with people that aren't with us right now so they can come back, you know, either on vacation or, you know, they're just out right now, Lord. So bring them back with us so we can worship with them. Lord, be with us today as we have a fun-filled day of worship and learning more about you and graduations and all that kind of good stuff, Lord. So we thank you. We especially thank you, Lord, for your son to come down on this earth and die for our sins. In his name we pray. Amen. So if we can stand, I'm going to need some help out there because these are some camp songs. And I know a lot of you guys were up at camp and you guys know them. So I want to hear you loud, please. Because when I'm watching out there, I'm not seeing you guys sing. I've got four other mics here. I will have you guys come up here. So, first one hymn is I Love You, the Lord Messiah. I love the Lord Messiah deep down in my heart. I love the Lord Messiah deep down in my heart. Say deep, deep, say down, down, say deep down in my heart. Hey, deep, deep, say down, down, say deep down in my heart. I love to sing his praises deep down in my heart. I love to sing his praises deep down in my heart. Say deep, deep, say down, down, say deep down in my heart. Oh, yeah. Deep, deep, say down, down, say deep down in my heart. I love my Christian family deep down in my heart. I love my Christian family deep down in my heart. Say deep, deep, say down, down, say deep down in my heart. Oh, yeah. Deep, deep, say down, down, say deep down in my heart. I love the Lord Messiah deep down in my heart. I love the Lord Messiah deep down in my heart. Say deep, deep, say down, down, say deep down in my heart. Say deep, deep, say down, down, say deep down in my heart. Amen. Said I wasn't. You guys got to get into this song. I want you guys clapping. I want you guys rolling, all that good stuff. So, said I wasn't going to tell anybody, but I said I was gonna tell anybody, but what the Lord has done for me, oh yeah, you ought to be there. When he saved my soul, you ought to be there. When he wrote my name on the roll, I'll keep walking, I'll keep talking, I'll keep singing, I'll keep shouting that the Lord has done for me, oh yeah. Said I was gonna pray about it, but I said I was gonna pray about it, but But the Lord has done for me. Oh, yeah, you ought to be there. Want to save my soul? You ought to be there. Want to take my name on the roll? I'll keep walking. I'll keep talking. I'll keep singing. I'll keep shouting at the Lord has done for me. Oh, yeah. Said I was going to sing about it, but I. No, I. No, no, I. Said I was going to sing about it, but I. What the Lord has done for me. Oh, yeah, you ought to be there. When he saved my soul, you ought to be there. When he raised my name on the roll, I'll keep walking, I'll keep talking, I'll keep singing, I'll keep shouting what the Lord has done for me. Oh, yeah. Said I was gonna shout about it no more. No, I. No, no, I said I was gonna shout about it, but I. What the Lord has done for me, oh yeah, you ought to be there. When he saved my soul, you ought to be there. When he wrote my name on the roll, I'll keep walking, I'll keep talking, I'll keep singing, I'll keep shouting what the Lord has done for me. Oh yeah, you ought to be there. When he saved my soul, you ought to be there. When he named his name on the roll, I'll keep walking, I'll keep talking, I'll keep singing, I'll keep writing what the Lord has done for me. Oh, yeah. Amen. You guys got me sweating. Woo. Have you seen Jesus, my Lord? Have you ever stood at the ocean with a white foam at your feet? Felt the endless thunder emotion? Then I'd say you've seen Jesus, my Lord. Have you seen Jesus, my Lord? He's here in plain view. Take a look, open your eyes. He'll show it to you. Have you ever stood at the sunset with the sky mellowing red? Seen the clouds suspended like feathers? Then I'd say you've seen Jesus, my Lord. Have you seen Jesus, my Lord? He's here in plain view. Take a look, open your eyes. He'll show it to you. Have you ever stood at the cross with a man hanging in pain? Seen the clouds suspended like feathers? And I say
you've seen Jesus, my Lord.
Have you seen
Jesus, my Lord?
He's here in plain view. Take a look,
open your eyes. He'll show it to you.
Have you ever stood in the family with the Lord there in your midst? seen the face of Christ in your brother, then I say
you've seen Jesus my Lord.
Have you seen
Jesus my Lord?
He's here in plain view. Take a look,
open your eyes, He'll show it to you.
You may be seated. The song before our communion is A Common Love. A common love for each other, a common gift to the Savior, a common bond holding us to the Lord, a common strength when we're weary, a common hope for tomorrow, a common joy in the truth of God's word. A common love for each other, a common gift to the Savior, a common bond holding us to the Lord. A common strength when we're weary, a common hope for tomorrow, a common joy in the truth of God's word.
Can you hear me now? There we go. There's lots of different things I've been thinking about over the past few weeks. But last night we had our awards banquet for our staff at Opportunity Camp. So they have the whirlwind of coming to camp, getting exhausted, and then we bring them together just to celebrate them because we have many that come from different areas to serve. And it was just, I didn't realize how many people had been there so many years. It's very refreshing, and it's something that if it gets in your blood, you want to be a part of it time and time again. For some people, it may be a one-time experience, and that's okay. But God calls us to serve. Jesus said, whatever you do, the least of our neighbors, you do for him. We serve the underserved in our community through Opportunity Camp Ministry. Children who may not have some of the privileges that a lot of our children may have. Children in foster homes and group homes, poverty-stricken families. These children come expecting nothing but gaining so much. Because when you serve with love, you impact lives. We claim at Opportunity Camp that we plant seeds of hope, of peace, of love, kindness, generosity. And these seeds are woven through our ministry throughout the day. And as we serve the children, it's those acts of grace that we do and the seeds that we plant that impact their lives. This week, we had a visitor from the town of Danville. The mayor came. I had talked to him 2 years ago about a possible type fundraiser thing that they came up with, and I was just waiting for money to come in from these guys, but it never developed. 2 years down the road, my company was doing some work in Danville. We reconnected with this mayor, and my coworker was with him on Friday prior to our camp. And he said, you know, that camp thing that Ken does, when is that? He goes, oh, it's happening this weekend. He goes, I want to visit it. So he came up, and I learned about this on Saturday that he was coming, and I was thinking, you know, how can I present this program to this man so that he can have a feeling for what we do when he's coming up for a morning? He just had a snippet. He was going on vacation on Tuesday, but he took the time to drive up. He seeked me out. He brought some little goodies, some little cupcakes, and some little breakfast bars, which was very nice of him. But I started introducing him to people and just said, how many years you been here? And people are telling him. He's like, oh, wow, oh, yeah, as he went around. And then I took him on a tour of the camp. And I don't know if you've ever been to the Daybreak facility, but down the hill there's, you know, trees and grass, you know, scattered among a swimming pool and a bunch of buildings that are there and a dining hall. But as you go up out of that, you go into the redwoods, and it's pretty magical for people that have never been there. And those are the words that he used. He said, this is like an enchanted forest. And I said, quick-witted that I was, I said, it's pretty magical for people. And he goes, yes. So I knew right there he was having an experience. And so I don't know why God brought him up there. But anyways, we came around, and then I called out in the boys' cabin, cabin four. We had a young man who was a camper for 4 years, and then he came back as a staff member for the past five. So I said, tell him, why do you come back? And he said, this program has made me the man that I am today. And I was like, ooh, that's good, that's good. And then he said, if it wasn't for these people, I don't know what I would be doing. And then he said, and I said, well, why'd you come back as a staff member? He said, if I can make a difference in one kid's life, like they did in mine, that's what I'm here for. This man reached over and shook his hand, and he was like, that's awesome. Congratulations, young man. We went down the hill. Then he asked me how much money the county gives us. I said, zero. He goes, why is that? There's money in the county budget. I go, that's what I'm asking you, my official. So the Lord put that on my heart. So I asked him, you know, that's what I asked you. So he went and left there with some questions. Again, a seed was planted in his life. And he got a snippet of what we do at camp. He was impacted by, we come in on Sunday with the kids. We bring them from here. We get up there. We get them into a routine, and we start going. But by the morning, these kids had followed suit that they were staying in their lines with their cabins, going through it. And he goes, they've been here not even a full day. This is amazing. I said, well, you know, we kind of have a program that we don't reinvent the wheel. We just do our thing. And it is a gives them some guidance and an outline of what we want. So anyways, God shows us many ways how we can serve. For some of you, it's teaching. Some of you, mission trips. Some of you may be serving a needy parent or a needy neighbor. But however we serve, let your light shine for Jesus. Let them see Christ living in you and being a living example, as our staff was at camp this week. So now as we take of the bread, I just ask you to bow with me in prayer. Heavenly Father, we're just thankful, Lord, for the many blessings that you give us. Father, you bless so many lives through the Opportunity Camp Ministry. And I just thank you for the gift that you give us of these children each year so that we can help mold them and love them and just reflect you in all that we do. And Father, now as we think about the blessings we have in life because of your son, Jesus. We ask that we partake of this bread in a way that makes us all be mindful of the body that he gave for each and every one of us. May it strengthen us, may it encourage us to be better Christians, to be better in our community, and to serve others as you ask us to. And it's in your holy name we pray. Amen.
Okay, now we're going to pray for the fruit of the vine. Heavenly Father, we just thankful, Father, for the blessings you give us. We're thankful for the opportunity we have to be brothers and sisters breaking bread together as a family. As we come to this table, Lord, we just thank you for your sacrifice. We're thankful for the hope that we have in you and the blessings that you put in our lives as Christians. Father, we just ask that this fruit of the vine will flow through our veins and give us the strength to step out of our comfort zones, to be united, to teach others, to love others, and be just gracious. Thank you for the unconditional love you had for me, for everyone here, and I thank you for the way that we can emulate you through our program of Opportunity Camp as we serve those children, through our missions that we do, through our classrooms and youth activities. Lord, bless us, guide us, and direct us, and it's in your holy name we pray. Amen.
Lastly, we have a time set aside where we give back to the Lord, and we're just going to pray over that offering. Heavenly Father, we're just thankful again for the way you blessed our lives. We're thankful that we have an opportunity to live in our homes, have nice cars, and that we can give back a portion to you, Lord, to impact those around us. I just ask you, Lord, to put your hand upon our elders, guide them in this process, that they'll make the right choices with the monies that we have put before them, that'll be magnified with your grace as you bless that, may it bless many others around us. Thank you for our teachers, Lord, for the sacrifice and the commitment they have, and what they do to our children. Bless them today, Lord, as they go before and lead our kids. May it be a blessing to all involved. Thank you for all you do in our life, and it's in your holy name we pray. Amen.
Yeah, we good? Yeah, we good? Thank you, Kenny, for sharing a lot about what happened at camp, because it really was an amazing week. It was my first time up there, and one of the kids said, so where do you go to church? And I go, I go to the Church of Christ in Walnut Creek. And they go, oh, you go to the mother church. And I was like, yes. It's like a ship. It's like the mothership. Anyway, but I was like, I do go to the mothership. Anyway, but I'm excited today because we get to acknowledge some of our graduates. We have four graduates who have graduated high school. We got a whole tier of them in junior high as well. But we wanted to go ahead and acknowledge them, so and just kind of celebrate them. We have some video that we're going to go ahead and show of three of our graduates. But it is a day that hopefully you might have some wisdom or some thought or some encouragement, or even deeper than that, some prayer. That you can just kind of lift them up and encourage them. I mean, to be a teen, to be a graduate in the year 2022, that is some uncharted territory for sure. Knowing which way to go, where to make the stand, where not to be type thing is a hard thing. So anyway, we're going to go ahead and acknowledge some of our graduates with watching the video, and then I'll share some a little bit right at the end.
I'm Reese Kay. I would like to thank God for the blessing of attending Berean, my family for their love, support, and laughter, my teachers for their daily examples of Christianity. I will be attending Oregon Tech in Klamath Falls, Oregon, majoring in mechanical engineering.
Just met you, seems like yesterday. You opened up your eyes and I recognized. past your face. You know that you're the one that we've been waiting for. We're gonna keep you safe. First time I held you in my arms, I knew I'd love you all the way. I took you in at night, another day has passed. Every week goes by a little faster than the last. It wasn't so long ago we walked together and you held my hand. But now you're getting too big to want to, but I hope you'll always understand that I'm always gonna lift you up, and I'm never gonna let you down. No matter what you do, I'm forever proud of you. I love you forever now.
The day has come to let you go. Only happiness I will show. I'll always be here for you, you know. Nothing takes away my love, and it shows. You've grown up now, things have changed. Grew some wings, now you're flying away. I'll always be here for you, you know. Nothing takes away my love, and it shows. Yeah, nothing takes away my love when I let you go. You're my baby, always will be. I hope you know my love stays when you go. Down the long, long road, if you need help with your load, I'll always be here for you, you know. Nothing takes away my love, and it shows. Yeah, nothing takes away my love when I let you go. You're my baby, always will be. I hope you know my love stays when you go. 'Cause you're my baby, always will be. I hope you know my love stays when you go. I'll let you go. I'll let you go. 'Cause you're my baby, always will be. I hope you know my love stays when you go.
On this day, to try to be kind in every way to every person, big and small. I will help them if they fall. When I love myself and others too, that is the best that I can do.
Ah, that's good stuff, huh? That is just good stuff. Again, the roots of what the families have presented and provided for these kids are pretty remarkable, truly. With Kyle, the Wallsmith family, with Reese and the Kent family, with Robert and the Mueller family, as well as Antonio with the Simeone family. It is a great example. It truly is. And it's hard because the word says that you are to lead the way and you are to prepare so that the kids will find a way to stay that path. But that doesn't mean that they'll always stay on it. It doesn't. But it means that they know the way back home when they're off it. And you guys have truly, truly shown that as an example, which has been pretty remarkable. And so congratulations to you seniors who are graduating. That's an exciting thing. That's a lot of accomplishment right there. I know that I was able to see a couple of the boys in real form over this last week up at camp, just loving on the kids and ministering and showing that grace and kindness and stuff and good stuff, as well as just being just kind of goobers, you know, just getting out there and playing and just still being boys and still being kids. It was really, really exciting with our four boys. And so, and in that, there's also, not to make it a huge thing, but we also have some junior high graduates as well that are right out of here, our eighth grade. We have Ryan Lilly, as well, and we have Coulter, we have Sam and Kenny Padilla, which is really an amazing thing. They really didn't want a lot of acknowledgement right now, is what they have been kind of been told, but Russ is going to come on up and pray for all of our graduates, which again is just a very exciting thing. So Russ is going to come on up. He be a daddy of one for sure.
All right, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we're so thankful for all of the graduates. We're so thankful that they've been blessed with families and with support and with so many of your blessings, Father. We know that that comes from you, and we want to celebrate with them at this time. It's a great thing. It's a great transition. It's an occasion that we want to mark and we want them to be joyful for, and in all of that we praise you. And Father, as Kyle and Antonio and Reese and Robert all go forward with their chosen path, we pray that you be with them, help them to continue to develop, help them to feel your presence in all aspects of their life, and just bless them as they go forward and help them to always have the comfort of knowing that you've got a great future plan for them and that you will be with them every step along the way. We pray this in your son's name. Amen.
Want to be able to encourage us as a body, us as a church. Mentoring is obviously an important thing, and you don't have to invest tons and tons and tons, but you passing on the wisdom of what you've experienced in life is honestly a calling that God has called the church to be, to pass that on to our youth. You know, they need you. If they've ever needed guidance and leadership and mentoring, they need it now. So please don't be afraid there. Today when you see the kids, you know, make sure that you just kind of not only congratulate them, but love on them. You know what I mean? Listen to them if they've got something to say, because this generation is our future, you know, and we need that wisdom from our church to be able to invest it in them. So let's go ahead and stand as we sing our final worship song with Steve.
I forgot to mention earlier, in the pew in front of you, there's some cards.
guests, we'd like to know that you're here. Fill this out. Let us know that you're here into the center aisle. Prayer card, if you have a special prayer that you want the elders and the body to pray about, please, on the blue card, put it on there. Again, pass it to the middle. And a word of encouragement. It's neat to get one of these from a fellow brother or sister. It just brightens up your day. So if you can, you know, I'm going to challenge you guys again. Is fill one of these out for one of your brothers and sisters next to you and pass it to the center aisle, and we'll make sure they get that. All I have to say is, we're empty nesters, yeah. I'm probably the biggest baby, though. You know, all my boys are up in Oregon going to school now. So the hymn before the sermon is "Our God, He is Alive." There is beyond the azure blue a God who seals from human sight. He tinted skies with heavenly hue and framed the worlds with his great might. There is a God.
There is a God.
He is alive.
He is alive. In him we live.
And we survive.
And we survive from dust our
God. Time ago, a God whose voice the prophets heard. He is the God that we should know, who speaks from his inspired word. There is a God.
There is a God.
He is alive.
He is alive.
In him we live.
In him we live.
Survive
from dust our
God.
Created man.
Created man.
He is our
God. He is our God.
The great I am.
The great I am.
Secure his life from mortal mind.
God holds the germ within his hand. Though men may search, they cannot find, for God alone does understand. There is a God.
There is a God.
He is alive.
He is alive.
In him we live.
In him we live.
And we survive.
And we survive from dust our God.
Sin might set man free, and evermore with him could live. There is a God.
There is a God.
He is alive.
He is alive. In him we live.
And we survive.
And we survive from dust our
God.
Created man.
Created man. God.
There is a God.
He is alive.
He is alive.
In him we live.
In him we live.
And we survive.
And we survive from dust our
God. Please be seated.
Good morning. You getting me? Yes? No? We are going to be honoring and praying for Jim and Kelly after our sermon time here this morning. You might notice that there's a few people around wearing op-camp shirts. It's kind of a tradition that if you've gone to camp to wear your shirt the next day at church. I had to go into the archives. This is from 2012 because apparently my shirt is out on Highway 680 somewhere. Kenny was driving back yesterday with a bunch of stuff. It's the end of the camp. Everybody's exhausted. He said he looks in the rearview mirror and he sees this whoosh, and then just everything just goes flying. And so he started calling people who were coming up behind, and yeah, they got video of stuff just strewn everywhere. So that's his new way to market camp, you know, to other areas, though. But, you know. So I'm stepping out of Philippians here for a Sunday just to kind of tie into our theme from camp for the last week. And several years ago, my mom took my family and my sister's family altogether on a cruise. My mom, that's something that she's always wanted to do during the summer. She wants to get our families together and do something. Well, one year we went on a cruise and we were in Alaska. We went down that interior passageway there and it was amazing. We saw so many just really neat things. Enormous glaciers that, you know, you get your pictures back and you're like, ah, no. It just doesn't cut it. And we were actually there when a big chunk fell in the ocean and it just went, water's going everywhere. And it was really neat. The food was amazing on the cruise ship. They had a basketball court on the top deck that my youngest son, Jackson, would go out and play on. And we see this incredible scenery every day. Toward the end, we came into port in a place called Ketchikan. And it was there that we learned a few things about Native American totem poles. And there are various kinds of totem poles. You can have a sort of family name or a family crest totem pole. They have mortuary totem poles. It would kind of be like a grave marker in our culture. They also have, this is what really piqued my interest. They have these things called shame totem poles. And this was primarily with the Tlingit tribe. And so if you had some sort of debt, and it can be, but it doesn't have to be a financial debt. You could have some sort of debt that's an ethical debt. What I mean by that, you know, you could have failed in some sort of moral way. You could have reneged on some moral responsibility. You could have just dropped the ball in a bad way. And it's sort of the Tlingit's people, their scarlet letter in their culture. Now, think about all of the ways that you have blown it. How would you like to have a bunch of personal shame poles out in public, because that's what they would do, on their property, they set these up for everybody to see. And they're there all the time. your flaws, your offense, your debt formalized in a public monument. And every day you get up and in your front yard, there's these gigantic poles that are out there that could say, liar, gossip, drunk, greedy. Probably not the curbside appeal you're looking for your home, right? Another thing I thought about was this. What would you do should you get a pole like that erected on your property if you were in the Tlingit tribe? If your debt was irreparable. What if it was beyond your ability to pay it off, beyond your ability to make amends? What is life going to be like for you knowing that that pole is out there for the rest of your life? Young Tlingit boy decides to play in the embers, the community fire. And as the light goes down later and later in the day, he gets a stick out and likes to run through, you know, just this glowing stick at the end. And he trips and falls and starts a fire that consumes a home for a family of six. And two of the six don't make it out of the home. How does he pay that off? How can that be made right? What will living in that village be like for him? You talk to somebody who's been in credit card debt for 4 or 5 years or 10 years or 20 years. And all of a sudden, some new expenses come along that they just have to be paid, some sort of health crisis. And it just comes up. And you know, you're never going to get out from under this. There is an enormous, not just financial, but emotional toll that this takes on you when you have this sort of huge Visa debt pole in your front yard. And the more I thought about those Tlingit shame totem poles and the stigma that they bring, the weight of those, I began to reflect on some truths that we see in the Bible. If we are to believe the Bible, and I hope you do that, then you and I, in a sense, have been accumulating shame totem poles over the course of our life. All of us have run up a sin debt. And truth be told, we don't like to think about this, but our shame poles are far more gruesome and far more numerous and far more sizable than we could imagine. What would your shame poles look like? What would the carvings be? You know, maybe it's your mouth that's gotten you in a lot of trouble. Your words have created relational and spiritual debt. And so maybe your totem might be a wolf, kind of carved with an open mouth, teeth bared, because your words have injured people. When I was about 6 or 7 years old, and I was living in West Virginia, there was a family that lived down the street from us, and they had a daughter named Helen. And Helen had a large birthmark that went along the side of her face and down her neck there. And I was either in first or second grade, I can't remember. But I said something about that, and I honestly cannot remember what I said at all. But she started crying. It hurt her. In And if her parents learned of that, I'm sure they were hurt as well. And that family could have carved a shame pole for me and stuck it right there in our front yard. And in a sense, a spiritual one was carved for me. And man, I so wished that I could erase that event and the hurt that I caused, but I couldn't do it. Can't go back in time. Maybe it wouldn't be a wolf for you. Maybe it could be a carving of a slyer animal, maybe an open-mouthed fox, because you knew how to use your words to get what you want. Not that concerned about how it might impact somebody else, but you know how to manipulate, how to work it. And people end up paying the expense of that. Maybe you've misled people for your own gain. Maybe it's not even for money or stuff. Maybe it's just to kind of boost your own image at the expense of somebody else. Some of us might be doing things with our bodies that we shouldn't be doing. Some of us might be partying too much. Maybe our culture doesn't have an issue with those things. But from God's perspective, you know, we're really not honoring him with our behavior. And we're earning shame totem poles. Some of us can get caught up in our own anger and earn some shame poles for that. Some of us have a problem with being honest about what we've really been doing with our time and our life and who we really are. Some of us might even be struggling to even like people. It's like the love of Jesus is having a hard time taking up residence within us. And again, spiritually speaking, you're earning a shame totem pole with that. Maybe you're someone who's taken pride in not having done some of these things, and you feel like God's got a little bit better deal on me than the guy who's got that really ugly, you know, adulterous shame totem pole in his front yard. And so your attitude and your heart, you know, kind of set you up to earn a self-righteous pole in your yard. So in the story of the Bible says that there is some bad news. The Bible says that we are fallen. We're fallen as a creation, and it is our nature to be selfish, to incur debt. It is our nature to earn shame totem poles. And we have all gone our own way and broken relationship with God. We have broken relationship with people. And the Bible calls that sin. And we have committed it. And there are times where we have honestly embraced it. And the damage and the distancing from God that's caused by our sin, the shame poles that we've earned, they are irreparable on our part. Too many, they're too big, and we can't make it right. And everybody's in the same boat. And Paul reminds the church in Rome, everybody's lawn is covered with shame poles, because all have sinned and all fall short of the glory of God. There's no one righteous, not even one. So we've got a big shame pole problem, and living with shame is really burdensome. In the Tlingit culture, if a debt that caused a shame pole to be erected in somebody's yard, if that is paid off, if a wrong is somehow righted, the shame pole was chopped down and burned. But you didn't take down the shame pole if you were the offending party. It is the offended party who would remove the burden and the shame. And there's obviously a huge relief that would be experienced by the formerly indebted person. They were now released. They were unburdened. Our theme from Opportunity Camp this week was One Life. And the passage that we focused on is familiar to you. For God loved the world in this way, that he gave his one and only Son, so that whoever would believe, and that believe is pisteo, which is a form of pistis, which means faith, but there's, in English, faith doesn't translate into believes or into faiths. We don't say faiths. But he's really talking about trusting and obeying, not just believing something in your head. He's talking about what you're going to set the weight of your life on, what you're going to trust and trust your life to, what you're going to follow. So I side challenge, read through the Gospel of John, and every time you see the word believe, say faiths. You'll get a better understanding, I think, of what John is getting at. But whoever faiths in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. And this is why. Because God didn't send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. And so, yes, the Bible says that there's some bad news, but God also has some very good news for us. God doesn't like, he really doesn't like us being stuck with all those ugly poles in our front yard. Makes our yards unsightly. It drives down property values of something that he's created to be good. They weigh us down. They suck away our hope. And God loves us way too much to leave us in that condition. And so God gets us out. And the cross of Jesus is how he does it. And through the cross, he pays all the debts. He removes all the shame. And removing those spiritual shame totems, it costs God a lot. But he is willing to pay. Isaiah 53 says this. He was pierced for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities. And the punishment that brought us peace, the punishment that removed our shame, our carved wolves, or whatever it is that's in your front yard, that punishment was on him. And by his wounds, we are what? We are healed. We're released from shame. And as far as the east is from the west, so far as he removed those shame totems from us. The Bible says in 1 Peter 2, he says also in Romans 9, that if we trust in him, we'll never be put to shame. You may still feel ashamed. Things you've done in your life is just hard to forget. Maybe you shouldn't forget them. You might still feel ashamed. That's how feelings work sometimes. But if you are in Jesus, there are no shame poles in your front yard. Whether you feel it or not, God's not holding anything against you. And that is good news. And so maybe the best way to send us out today is to hear Jude's blessing to some early Christians as he thought about his brother Jesus. And so if you could just bow your heads, let me bless you with the words of Jude. To him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you before his glorious presence without fault, without your shame poles, and with great joy. To the only God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, power, and authority through Jesus Christ our Lord, before all ages, now and forevermore. Amen. Let's go ahead and stand and sing.
I guess I should be careful for when I say empty nesters. That just means more trash work I have to do, more lawn work I have to do. So I shouldn't be too happy then. So our last hymn of the will be "I Love You with the Love of the Lord." We'll sing it twice. I love you with the love of the Lord. Yes, I love you with the love of the Lord.
I see in you the glory of my King, and I love you with the love of the Lord. I love you with the love of the Lord. We love you with the love of the Lord. I see in you the glory of my King, and I love you with the love of the Lord.
Amen. Please be seated.
So we're going to take a minute here to honor and pray for Jim and Kelly. I'm going to be brief because I'm real unhappy about this. Man, you guys have served us so well in so many ways. You've been so hospitable to people, not just here, but in your own home. You have shared what God has put on your heart in our classes, and from old people like me down to kids. Kelly is just really blessed. And feel like I'm losing some good friends. So I just want to thank you for being in my life. And I'm going to ask Bob to come up here and share.
Well, Dave, I feel the same emotions you do, and I hope I don't show it too much, because I have things to say to Jim and Kelly. It's been a great week. I was at Opportunity Camp with Kenny and Dave and Eric and Maddox and all of you. My buddy Russ, who was the first time in the cabin. And it's been hard work for everybody. These young people, dishwashers, had fun watching them. We served the kids and got a lot out of it. It was fun. And it's been fun celebrating these young people graduating and everything. This part isn't really fun to me. You know, I feel the same way as Dave. Jim came on as a co-shepherd. I've learned to use that word now because Michelle is too young to be the wife of an elder. He has really been a blessing to me. He saw a need for strengthening the eldership as Ken Stevens was getting ready to step down. And I didn't realize that Jim's been an elder almost as long as I have. About a year, maybe, difference. And he just stepped in and helped us grow the eldership with Dave and Russ joining us. He's been such an important part of the leadership here in Walnut Creek. He's a good businessman. He's very organized. He's a good tech type of guy. Helps an old guy like me in that way. But he's a great Christian man. And, you know, somebody told me a long time ago that behind every good man is a good woman. So, Kelly, when I talk about Jim, I'm talking about you too. Jim and I have shared a lot of things. He's been a real friend to me. He's a great friend keeper. You know, many of you have known Jim for a long time. He's one of these guys, I have a son-in-law that's kind of that way. You know, he reaches back and just stays in touch with people that he's known along the way. I don't know how he finds time to do all the things that he does. Pretty successful in his business along the way, you know, something extra he picked up. But he's a great example to watch and to try to be like. And as an older guy, I've watched him and I wanted to be like him when I grow up. So I can't say enough, Jim. You know, I've got notes and I thought, you know, it's here. And you know, Jenny asked me this morning, you know, what are you going to say? And I said, I don't know. It's here and it's here. I've got some notes, but I hope that you understand the love that Dave and I and everybody here has for you guys, Jim and Kelly. Kelly girl, I'm going to miss having Kelly girl around and calling her that. So I'm going to stop about right here before I'm going to ask Russ and Dave and Dave. And you guys come on up. And I'd like to pray. And then come on up, Todd. Yeah. I'll step down here with you guys. Yeah, before we pray, let's see. Go ahead, Jim.
So we've been doing a lot of goodbyes to people the last couple months, but this is one I knew this day was coming, and not looking forward to this time. And we were doing pretty good this morning until A Common Love. We were singing that, and then I Love You with the Love of the Lord. So. I mean, this, we came to this church in 1999, so we were in our late 30s, Brooke was 13, Allison was 11, came here looking for a church. Primarily, the youth group was what the draw was. Woody Square, who was our youth minister at San Leandro, where we were going, we had moved to San Ramon, and he kept saying, "You got to check out Walnut Creek." He kept talking about Kenny and what was happening with Op Camp, and that's what brought us here. And but it's just became our home from that point. And you guys loved us. We felt part of this community. It gave us opportunities to serve. We served with the youth group for several years with Body Life, and then, as Bob mentioned, you know, 2010, so it's gone 13 years as a shepherd. And I mean, this church is really where we were talking about this morning, just that we really kind of came to our faith here, I think, where it became our faith. And you guys were part of that journey. I will say that the time went fast, it feels like. I look at some, you know, there was only a handful of you here when we got here, and I see a few of them here in the audience. So I would say if you're in your late 30s right now, man, don't blink, because you'll be 60-ish very soon. So it went very fast. I appreciate the thoughts you guys had. I feel the same way. I mean, this church is so blessed with Dave and Todd. I mean, the quality that this church has in ministers for our size church, I mean, you're not going to find it out there. And we're so blessed. And we've been so spiritually fed from your words, Dave, all these years, and just from our relationship. And Todd, you've been just a bolt and jolt of energy for this church. You're doing great things. So I want to say to you guys, just keep moving forward. This church is with you and behind you and wants to do great things. And for you guys, it's been an honor to serve with you, Dave and Russ, and especially this guy. And we know that this church is going to continue to do great things. And it's going to be led by God's Spirit and continue to touch lives. And we just thank you for letting it touch our lives. So before you pray, I would like to say a short prayer. God, I want to thank you so much for this church. Thank you for how much they've loved us and supported us and given us an opportunity to serve you. And I just pray that you'll continue to bless this church, bless the leadership, bless the ministers and staff, and bless every part of this community. God, we love them so much. And we just ask that you just continue to hold them in your hand and continue to bless them in your son's name. Amen.
Thank you, Jim. Let's continue that prayer. God, it's hard to put into words, but we love Jim and Kelly, and we're going to miss them a lot. Just thank you for the years of being with us, the friendship, the love, the way they've served our church. I know there's somebody out there looking forward to having them come into their community, and I know that they will continue to serve you as they have here, and they'll be a blessing where they land. I know that you have plans for them. I know that they listen to you and they'll follow your direction. So bless them as they go from here. Bless their family, God. It's just a blessing to them at this point in their life to be able to unite with their family all in one area. I just love that for them. And that's just the way you look out after your people. Just continue to bless Jim and Kelly and their family with all the good things that you give us. And we pray this in your son's name. Amen.
This has definitely been an unusual day, but a rich day, hasn't it? We've been blessed. We have several prayers that we need to be aware of today. One from Eric Johnson, who says he asked for us to pray a prayer of praise and thanks for God's hand in having a safe and successful camp this past week. He says it was amazing, and I think you've gotten a sense of that already. Alex Altizer asks that we pray for her very good friend, Mindy. She was diagnosed with breast cancer. And she asked that we please pray for healing that was caught early and that God heal her completely. And then from Angela Rose, she says, I will be serving at a disability camp July 10 through 15 and would like prayer that the other volunteers and I would serve humbly as the hands and feet of Jesus. That's a prayer we can all pray every day, isn't it? We be the hands and the feet of Jesus. I know there's others that we need to pray for. I want to thank all those who've had part in leading our worship and those in the background in the audiovisual. And for all those who are online as well as those present, that you've been part of it. Now, sometimes we think that those who are not seen are not necessarily here with us. But I know from joining in worship online, as many, many of you have done in the past, that we're not distanced from that. We're worshiping even though we're at a distance. And so we're joining in and participating with those who are here, with everything that's going on. We are one body. Amen? We are one body, loving God, serving God, worshiping God. Let's pray. Father, we're so thankful that you bless us in so many ways. We're so thankful that you've drawn us here this morning. We pray that it might not be in some casual way or some traditional way or some other kind of way that is secondary, but that we have come here with priority and with a primary responsibility and joy of seeking you, of praising you, of thanking you, of recommitting to you. We pray, Father, that you would help us to be a people more each day who honor you through our lives, who reflect you living in us, who would bring people to you because we are thankful for our relationship to you. And because, Father, we know that life eternal is based upon our relationship with you. We ask, Father, that you would bless those that cannot be with us because of health issues. We pray that you would be with them as they are healing. We pray, Father, for healing to come in a variety of ways according to your will and your blessings. And we pray, Father, that you would help us to be encouragers of all those around us, particularly of your body. We do thank you, Father, for this past week at Op Camp. We pray, Father, that you would bring about many more such times year after year over an extended period of time, that you have an opportunity to work through us to bless many people. We pray for Mindy, for Alice's friend, that you would give her healing, that you would give her life, and that you would bring her ever closer to you because of it, and her family as well. And we pray, Father, for Angela Rose, that you bless her and the fellow volunteers who will be working at camp, that they would be blessed by you and led by you in all that they do, that they may reflect you and glorify you and bring others to you. Father, there's so much that we can be thankful for all of our graduates, for all those who were touched by you at Opportunity Camp this past week, and for those, Father, that will be in weeks and days and months ahead. We pray that you would be in our lives actively, and we pray, Father, that you would help us to seek you and your will to your glory. All this we pray through Christ's name. Amen.
It really has been a great, 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 great day. Just a couple of real quick announcements as we close up. We have our summer song series, and what that is each week right after the service at 11:15, after we visit a little bit, we're able to meet right in here and sing and worship. And if you are interested in doing that, please make sure that you stick around. If you've got questions about the worship team as it is, please make sure you talk to Michelle. She's a servant-hearted person there. And make sure that you stay connected with that. Also, if you haven't been able to be a part of it, we are having our midweek, kind of, I guess, our Tuesday night Bible study that we do, and we do it online on Zoom. And we're not having our pantry date until July 7th, but we are having that, which is only in a couple weeks. That's on a Thursday if you've got any questions about that. And also on July 10th, we're having our all church fellowship time after the service. Well, we're barbecuing, and I'll tell you, up at camp, we had barbecues going all the time, and I'll tell you, our church was always right smack dab in the middle of that. So it's going to be a great time together. Let's go ahead and stand as we continue our time of fellowship. I'm going to pray for us one more time. We can't pray enough, right? Make sure that God is included in everything we do. So let's go ahead and pray. Lord, I know that you gather your church in lots of different ways, and the hardest one is when you multiply it by dividing sometimes. And I know that Paul had to do that, go through it with Barnabas and Mark. And I know, Lord, that it's a part of your way and your will. So I do ask that extra added blessing over the Henrys, Lord, that just that you would multiply. You'd continue to produce fruit through their lives as you continue to help some of us within this body right here off of 500 Minot Road, Lord, that you would help us to step up and serve where you've called us to serve. It's not that they got to fill the holes, Lord. We just got to fill our purpose with you. And that might be in teaching Sunday school. It might be stepping up and encouraging and helping and loving and sticking around late sometimes. So, Lord, just use your hands and feet right here, too. I was reminded this week, Lord, that this church is a valuable place to be. It's a precious, precious family. And we give you praise for that. It's in your name we pray. Amen, amen. If you want to continue our time in fellowship and worship, please make sure you make your way down. If you got time to love on the Henrys, I'm sure it's going to be a blurry day for them today. But our youth will go ahead. Our youth Sunday school classes are going to be meeting in just about 5 minutes. Our youth will be meeting in the youth room. So God bless you today.